Hello, good morning church. I'm Asaze.
My name is Calvin.
We live amongst three other brothers in an incredible residence in Buxton Road, Maryland. Please come along and visit us one day. Today in this welcome, we wanted to share about peace and basically how we can connect more in trying to find that peace in God, especially during our time at church today. So without further ado, if you could join us in turning to Isaiah 26 verse 3, that would be much appreciated. I'm going to try and read from there now. So in Isaiah 26 verse 3, it reads, "You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast, because they trust in you." Now, I feel this passage is so telling of how great it is to be with God when we trust in Him. The Bible describes the peace we can find as a perfect peace. And I do feel that in life, we can never really ever avoid strife. We can never avoid difficulty, hardship, and troubles. But God's peace enables us to be in a place where we can never be shaken, regardless of our surroundings and regardless of the chaos that we might have. And so here at church, this is a perfect place where we have the space to continually try and fill ourselves out with God's peace and to have that be our primary focus throughout the service. And so just in terms of my journey, before I hand it over to Calvin to discuss more on his own journey with peace currently right now, I want to encourage all of you to know that regardless of what our weeks have been, our weeks could be fantastic, our weeks might be not so fantastic, regardless of the World Cup, regardless of Thanksgiving, regardless of Black Friday, let us try and put all things aside from God to aside and give God the glory today as we worship Him and connect with Him at church. I'll now hand over to Calvin to share more about his journey in peace.
Yeah, thanks for sharing that, OJ. I just wanted to kind of speak on the idea of the perfect peace that's kind of talked about in that scripture. I think this is the kind of journey that I've been on for a while now, and I think in our discipleship, it's a constant battle, it's a constant journey, trying to seek out that perfect peace. I think that is really an issue. I think personally for me in the past year, there's been a lot of struggle, a lot of trying to figure out, man, what am I doing here? What am I trying to achieve? What are my goals in life? And I think in so many different aspects, I can place my value in kind of what the world tells me. Just trying to figure out who you are based on the world's kind of standards of validation, I think that will lead you down a tumultuous path, lead you down the path of really second guessing yourself, really not knowing how much you're actually worth and how much God actually sees you as being very worthy. I think that's one thing that we're so encouraged about by being in this virtual space right now and gathering together on a Sunday. I think this kind of block of time really forces us to just be mindful of our value, be mindful of really who our Creator is and how encouraging it is to kind of take part in his vision for who we are. I think that's such an encouraging thing and has always been encouraging for me when I have a crazy time. I'm getting rejected by these many jobs. I'm trying to do all these other stuff in my personal life that may not be working out. I think being able to come to church and have that rest and leave all those things behind, recognize that my worth is in God, brings me kind of that perfect peace that we're talking about in the scripture. And I think it's just so encouraging that we can all take part in that this morning.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Calvin, for your sharing. We now just pray quickly and then we'll continue with the rest of the service. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Dear Father God, thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to worship you and to connect with you and to draw closer to you, Father God. Thank you for giving us family, giving us a body of believers who all, as imperfect as we may be, really want to connect with you and try to draw closer to this beautiful gift of perfect peace that we're able to find in you, Father God. I pray for the service today, regardless of wherever we might be. I know many of us are just trying to connect with you in various different house churches. Father, I just pray for everyone during this time. I pray that we can all really, really try to just draw closer to you. Help us, Lord, if we have things in our minds that are really just on our hearts to quite a big level. Lord, I just pray you can help us to put those all to a side and just give you the glory today, to find that rest, to feast on every good and perfect thing that comes from you, Father God, and to ultimately just draw closer to you so that we're able to grow and push on for the coming week, Father. We love you so much. We thank you for every good and perfect thing that comes from you. And we pray for the rest of the service. In your son's name, I pray. And we pray, Father God, amen.
Amen.
No more crying there.
No more crying there.
Crying there.
No.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome again to our virtual service here on YouTube. And no, it is not too soon to be talking about Christmas, though for some of you, you might have that strong conviction that it is. We're not even in December yet, but it is Christmas soon. And here's a little confession, okay? Amy, my wife, has been playing Christmas music for the last couple of weeks, okay, which... maybe I shouldn't call that a confession. I'm more just kind of grassing her up a little bit, because that's definitely too soon. And I've been a little bit of a Scrooge when the Christmas music has been coming on. But I'm starting to get into the Christmas spirit. And today feels like perhaps the first Sunday where it's appropriate. Today is the first Sunday in Advent. We officially have four more Sundays until Christmas. Christmas then being the fifth Sunday. So time is ticking, we're getting closer, and it might be time to start getting into the Christmas spirit, okay? But we're not here to talk about Christmas, at least not trees and snow and everything else. We're here to talk about Jesus, and we want to look at some scriptures today and really talk about a very specific topic today. We're going to be talking about the topic of building one another up, right? That's today's theme for the service. But very specifically, I actually want to talk about a topic called discipling, okay? This word discipling. Now, before I lose any of you, I just want to clarify that the lesson we're going to have this morning, I really hope is going to be accessible to all of you, whether you have no idea what this word means. Perhaps you're just visiting here, tuning in for first time or a few times, it's totally fine. Or maybe you have a long history and this word has meant different things to you over different times, or there's certain baggage that comes to the table with that. So here's what I want to do just to kick off this morning. I want to ask you all a question. The question is this: what comes to mind when you think of the word discipling? What thoughts come to mind? Perhaps also what emotions, feelings, things like that come to the table as you think about this word. And here's what I'll do. I'll actually give us a little bit of time, actually however much time you want to discuss. Okay, the beauty of being on YouTube is we can pause if you would like to. You can even turn me off if you really want to, but I hope you won't do that. But you can pause. So if you're in a group setting, in a house church or wherever else, if you would like to, you could pause now. Just have a quick discussion about this, just to understand what are we coming to this discussion, this lesson with? What thoughts or perspectives? Because we really want to have an open mind and an open heart as we look at the Bible together. Right, so if you want to pause, now's your opportunity. I'll give a little countdown and then we'll carry on. 3, 2, 1. Welcome back. If you had a discussion, welcome back. If not, let's carry on with the lesson. Here's where I want to start for us this morning, okay? So hopefully you've had the chance to think about that, perhaps even discuss this idea. And here's what I want to do just to begin with. I just want to break down some wording and some terminology that we use in our church or in Christian circles, and I'll probably use today. I'm going to call this our Christianese, okay? The language we use within Christianity. So there's a few words. I'm just going to break down three words for us just to start off so we understand what we're talking about. The first is disciple. We use the word disciple a lot because it really suggests the idea of being a follower or a student, in this case specifically, of Jesus. John 8:31, in his very own words, Jesus says, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free." We like to use the word disciple describing one another because it, again, suggests this idea rather than being watered down by other terminology people could use, which doesn't necessarily always reflect what Jesus was talking about. And obviously, we want to get in this idea. We're following Jesus. He's Lord. He's Savior. He's our standard to imitate. Okay, so that's what we mean when we talk about disciple. Then this word we're going to be talking about today, discipling, okay? I'll try and get myself out of the way a little bit. Sorry. The discipling, what I'm really talking about when I use that word, it's like an umbrella term which describes our one another relationships, effectively where we help each other as disciples of Jesus. Okay, so I'm a disciple, I'm trying to follow Jesus. You're a disciple, you're trying to follow Jesus. We're trying to help one another in our following of Jesus. And we call that dynamic discipling, helping one another to grow, to be more and more like Jesus. Okay, and then lastly, the final term I'll look at as well this morning here is the term discipler. Okay, this is kind of a term we give to a specific relationship where there's a discipler helping a disciplee. Taken perhaps from like Matthew 28:19-20, where Jesus says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and then teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. The reason I mention all these three words, especially this last one, is I want to break down a little bit some of our thoughts or feelings around some of these words. And that last word there, honestly, it was probably the one I wrestled most with as I was preparing this lesson. It's the one where I felt like, oh, there's something can feel slightly off about that sometimes. And here's where I'll start. I personally have always had mostly had a fantastic experience with other disciples having great discipling relationships. I personally have no problem being in these kind of relationships where, you know, someone is a discipler to me. I'm trying to learn from them. They're way ahead of me on the journey. Perhaps they're training me in something very specific, whether that being a father or a husband, or if I'm, you know, when I was a young Christian, I was learning the ropes, whatever it may be. I have no problem with that at all. But it is worth having a little bit of a thought and a caution. Sometimes that can get skewed. And I want to set this as the groundwork first to make sure that we all understand how it can get skewed and make sure that we don't allow it to get to that point as well. There's an interesting scripture here in 1 Corinthians 3 that I'll share. In verse 1, it says, brothers and sisters, right? Paul writes into the Corinthian church. He says, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you are not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere humans? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not mere human beings? What, after all, is Apollos? And what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe. As the Lord has assigned to each his task, I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God has been making it grow. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. This is a really helpful scripture. Obviously, Paul is challenging the church here for this worldliness. And a very specific nature of this worldliness is they were effectively putting Paul or Apollos in a place that's only reserved for Jesus. It's really only Christ that should be Lord and head. He is the person we're following. And like I said, in our discipling relationships, we're trying to help each other follow Jesus. And at times, it's very appropriate to have a relationship where someone's that much ahead of you, and you might refer to them as your discipler and vice versa. That can be totally fine, but we got to make sure we don't get that skewed and we don't give that role too much authority or power that really should only be reserved for Jesus. So it is an area we've got to be able to guard our hearts and be aware of and be discerning of, but also an area not to overreact to and try and get rid of these kind of relationships or roles at all. A similar thing is mentioned here in Matthew 23, but I won't read this for time, but Jesus is obviously instructing and warning the disciples about what happens. And you can pause and read that yourself. Again, I'm putting these on the screen so that if you would like to, in your small groups, discuss some of them or what this means or how we can get skewed in our discipling relationships. These are some good questions for this to do. But the principle here is making sure Jesus is still Lord, that he is kept as head. He's Lord. He's the one we're following. He's the ultimate teacher. We're students and servants of Jesus. Okay, that's what's most important. So let's move on. What is discipling? Okay, so hopefully I've got some terminology out of the way, addressed some of the dynamics in our roles and relationships. So let's talk a little bit about what is discipling. And here's where I want to start. I want to go back to Matthew 28. Ah, Matthew 28, not Matthew 18. I'm sorry for getting that misquoted. I apologize. Okay. But Matthew 28, verse 16 to 20, it reads this. It says, "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age.'" This is a great place to start because it describes, I think, some of the intentionality behind discipling relationships. Jesus gives them a very active command to go. You go and you make disciples. And part of that process is teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. So it's the 11 who have spent these years with Jesus. They've learned from him. They've seen him. They've seen his lifestyle. They've seen his heart. They've seen what he teaches and what he does. And Jesus goes and gives them a command. Now you need to go out and you need to be making disciples of others, teaching them as well everything that I've taught you, passing it on. So Jesus kind of sets this process, these relationships, in a way that they're very intentional, very proactive. This isn't something that just happens as, you know, if we don't do anything. It's a very active command. Here's another scripture I really, really love. It shows Paul's heart for the church. And we'll read here in Colossians chapter 1, verse 28, and through to chapter 2, verse 4. It reads, "He is the one we proclaim," talking about Jesus, "admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. To this end, I strenuously contend with all the energy that Christ so powerfully works in me." He goes on in chapter 2 and he says, "I want you to know how hard I am contending for you and for those at Laodicea and for all who have not met me personally. My goal is that they may be encouraged in heart and united in love, so that they may have the full riches of complete understanding, in order that they may know the mystery of God, namely Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I tell you this so that no one may deceive you by fine sounding arguments." Okay, this is a really, really helpful verse here. And I love just some of those first few lines. Paul is strenuously contending with, like, again, Christ working in him. Okay, not his own power, not his own wisdom, but through Christ. But he is strenuously contending for people. Why? For what purpose? Well, he says, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. So this idea of spiritual maturity, a spiritual formation, perhaps we understand that terminology, growing to be more like Jesus, growing to be closer to God, growing in our walks with him. But there's an intentional relational dynamic between us and other Christians. In this case, Paul strenuously working for the church in Colossae and all over as well. And he wanted them to know how hard he was contending for them. He wanted them to understand his heart for them. And he did that in multiple ways, admonishing and teaching, all kinds. And we'll talk about that in a moment, like some of the tools of discipling. But I really want to establish first this heart. What is discipling? Why do we do it? Ultimately, we do it because we love God. We want to be more like Jesus. We just want to keep growing in our walks with him, in our followership, our studentship. I don't think that's a word, but you know what I mean. We want to keep growing. And God has put us in a family, in a community, where we can really help one another and aid one another in this walk together, being alongside each other. Sometimes a little bit ahead, sometimes learning different things from people's different strengths. There's a whole beautiful array of how these relationships can exist, but there's a real heart behind it. Lastly, just to drive this point home before we move on to the next and kind of final point, I'll give you some other scriptures. Again, you could pause if you want to at this point. You could read through these in detail, discuss them with your group and house church. You can do that if you'd like to. Now would be a great time to pause. I'm going to read through them briefly, But if you'd like to, you can read through them in more detail. But let me start here, okay? Again, it just reinforces the heart. In Galatians 4, Paul actually talks about it being like the pains of childbirth that he's going through again until Christ is formed in you. You see just his heart of love and of care for the church. And he's going through what he describes as labor pains. In Ephesians 4, it talks about us no longer being infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and carried around by every wind of teaching. Instead, right, and not carried away by the cunning of men and deceitful scheming. So we're not thrown around, but it says instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow up in all things. We will in all things grow up into Christ himself, who is the head. So how do we grow up in Christ? Well, we keep speaking the truth in love. We keep loving each other enough to share the truth with one another. Okay. What about here in Proverbs 27? This can be a bit of a challenging verse, you know, but it says, better is open rebuke than hidden love. I'm like, first, what does that mean? But when I really think about it, I'm like, do I want someone who, you know, they really love me, they really care about me, but I don't really know. I never actually hear it. Or someone who is actually kind of loves me enough to kind of rebuke me, speak the truth. Perhaps even if it's maybe a little bit harsh, they didn't do it in the best way they possibly could have. What would I rather? Honestly, really, if my pursuit is about following Jesus, I would rather someone rebuke me, correct me, even if it was slightly too harsh. I'd rather them do that than have someone who loves me, but keeps their mouth closed even when they see things in my life that's scary or alarming, or they see things which is concerning or not spiritual, but they're just going to keep quiet about that. That's not really love, and that's not what we're called to in our relationships. Romans 15 is a really good one as well. Paul says, and I've cut some bits out, but he says, I myself am convinced, my brothers and sisters, that you yourselves are full of goodness, filled with knowledge, and competent to instruct one another. There's a one another dynamic in our instructing. It isn't always the case. We always need the teacher to pass it down to us. There's some greatness where we can teach each other, which is Paul as he speaks to the church. They can do this amongst themselves. And some guidance here in Galatians 6. Someone's caught in sin, you who are spiritual and in following the Spirit should restore that person gently. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. All of these give slightly different dynamics of what our discipling relationships should look like, but really the heart behind them. It's ultimately love. It's ultimately because we want to see everyone grow in Christ. It's ultimately for the glory of God and helping each other in our followership of Jesus. Amen. Hopefully that's helpful. Like I said, you can unpack this more. You could discuss this in a group, or perhaps just take these scriptures away and reflect on them. But for now, I'm going to move on and I'm going to talk about some tools of discipling. What do I mean by some tools of discipling? I mean kind of the how. Well, so how does this exist? What are boundaries? What's too much? Even when I talked about corrected harshly, like what is harsh? What's not? What are some limits and boundaries to this? Okay, which I'll look at in a moment. But you know the phrase, if the only tool in your toolbox is a hammer, then every problem looks like a nail. Okay, so for example, if the only tool at your disposal is the rebuke. Okay, so every time you see anything, you get angry, there's shouting, or you just show lots of passion and conviction, but it's way too much. Okay, then every time, every little problem, you're going to deal with it in that way. It's not going to be helpful. But if the only tool in your toolbox is just empathy or listening, that's a really good thing. But if that's the only thing, then you're never actually going to instruct someone or admonish or teach or anything more than that. You'll only ever listen and won't always be helpful. Okay, so for all of us, we've all got our strengths and weaknesses. And that's why a variety of relationships are really helpful, because there are different discipling relationships we have which can give us different things. But for all of us as disciples wanting to follow Jesus, it's great that we grow in these areas at the same time. So I'm going to give us now just a few scriptures to think about how we do this. 1 Thessalonians 5:14 is a really good scripture. And he reads this. He says, and we urge you, brothers and sisters, to warn those who are idle and disruptive, to encourage the disheartened, to help the weak, to be patient with everyone. Let's consider each of these in turn, okay? So firstly, it says, if someone is idle and disruptive, what should be the approach then? Well, then it should be more of a warning that we need to warn that person. Perhaps warn them about the effects of their idleness and disruptive on their own lives, on the lives of others, but there needs to be more of a firmness, more of a warning. What about someone's really disheartened? Maybe they're down, they're discouraged, they're kind of losing hope or faith. Well, that person really needs encouragement. We need to be able to lift them up. We need to be able to inspire them, show them what God is doing around them, in them, and through them. What about if someone's weak? What do you do if someone's weak? It says, well, we help them. You know, if someone's weak, it means maybe they really want to. Maybe they're really trying. Maybe there's a faith there. A weakness is like, I just can't do this right now. I'm flailing. I really, really need help. And with everyone, at all times, we need to be patient. Any of us, if you've ever been, which all of us have, in any relationship with any human being, you realize we really need patience. I have needed a lot of patience over the years, and I'm so grateful for the people that have needed patience, have had patience with me. So we always have patience, but it's this idea, different strokes for different folks. We different approaches in different situations, right? If someone were idle and disruptive, but it was just kind of a gentle encouragement, maybe it wouldn't help them change in the way they needed. But if someone was weak or disheartened and your approach was to warn them, that just might create, they might break if they were weak, or if they're disheartened, they're probably going to get more discouraged. So it takes different approaches depending on what someone is at, somewhere someone is at. And what else does that take? It does take empathy. It does take listening. It does take understanding. It takes getting alongside someone, not just viewing it from the outset, making a really quick judgment and knowing exactly what they need. It takes love and care to engage with one another, consider actually what each other needs, pray through that, ultimately really using the scriptures as well to lift someone up. So that's a bit of an idea and framework, but 1 Thessalonians 5 isn't exhaustive, right? To warn, encourage, help, be patient. They're not the only descriptions that the Bible gives about our one another relationships as we disciple each other. So what I'm going to put up now, I'm going to put up a list. Now, don't get overwhelmed. It's a list of scriptures. I'm not going to go through them all in great detail, but once again, it's just a helpful resource for you if you would like to discuss these more or look into them together. But I will go through this fairly briefly to describe just all the various dynamics of how the Bible describes our one another relationships. So let's look here. There's 11 of these that I'll go through very quickly. We've already looked at the first, which is to warn, to encourage, to help, to be patient. I just want us to consider the wording it uses. It also says to encourage one another. And number 3 is it talks about Jesus being full of grace and truth. In Ephesians, it talks about speaking the truth in love. Proverbs 20 verse 5, one of my favorite scriptures, talks about our hearts being really deep waters, but the man of understanding drawing out those deep waters. The ability to really be discerning, to ask good questions, to get to the bottom of what is someone really feeling or thinking, what's deep down, is such a great one. If you want to study for that, if you look in 1 Samuel, I think it's around chapter 15, seeing the interaction between Samuel and Saul after Saul went to a battle, disobeyed God, seeing the way Samuel gets through to really what's going on in Saul's heart is an incredible study if you would like to go deeper. Teach in Colossians 3, to teach or to admonish. That's like a more of that strict warning. But again, it talks about the word of Christ dwelling in us richly. In our one another relationships, it shouldn't be our opinions or even our emotions or what we think at that time. Really should be the word of God that we're helping one another with to make sure we're not skewed by our own perspectives or views or opinions, but we're really, again, pointing someone to Jesus, helping them from the truth of the word. 2 Timothy 3 talks about teaching, you know, passing on knowledge, rebuking, correcting, training. There's a variety of ways we can be using the word with each other. Romans 15, we looked at instructing one another. Proverbs 27, talking about sharpening one another. As iron sharpens iron, one man or one woman sharpens another. Then there's the words of training as well. Older women training younger women, fathers training children. This helping between different generations, different ages, different relationships. I quote here Matthew 7 as well. Take the plank out of your own eye before you take the speck out of someone else's. Humility is really needed. That's a great tool in our discipling relationships. That again, we don't fly in with quick judgments with a massive plank hanging out of our own eye. It's a phrase I like. It's one beggar showing another beggar where their bread is. It's not I'm over you, I'm better than you, I'm superior. It's, hey, here's some things that have helped me. This might be helpful for you. Now, I'm not just going to shy away from it because I love you, but I need to do this in humility. I need to take the plank out of my own eye as I come. And then there's loads. I just quoted, like, there's 9 references here to imitation. You know, sometimes that's Paul calling Timothy to imitate him or imitate these other people, or whatever that may be. But imitation is a great way for us to grow. Sometimes looking around the church, finding people who I really respect and admire in a particular area and thinking, man, I really want to be like them. They have so many strengths where I don't. I want to imitate them. And like I said, right back to the beginning, perhaps that comes in a fairly formal training relationship. Myself and Amy, we're married, but sometimes it's a case of, hey, we really need help in our marriage. Can you just disciple us for a period of time? Or in our parenting, or a number of areas where I admire you in this area, I want to learn from you. I want to imitate you, whatever that may be. Here's just a variety of scriptures to get us to consider how we do this in our one another relationships. As we disciple one another, as we continue to follow Jesus and learning from each other. We're going to close now. I want to close with a thought for communion as we take bread and wine, as we pray together, as we remember what this is all about. But I want to offer you some discussion questions, okay? Which, again, you can go away and reflect by yourself, or you could discuss this in your group together. And here are just three questions. Number one, what is your perspective on discipling? Kind of asked that at the beginning, but even after this, looking through the scriptures, really questioning where we're at. And how might it need to change to be more in line with God's word? And that's one to really reflect on and think about. Do I have a skewed perspective of discipling? For some of us, maybe we've had bad experiences in this. Maybe we're hurt. Maybe we're wounded. Maybe we shy away from it altogether. For some others of us, maybe we're harsh. Maybe there's only one way we do this and we've learned some bad habits in our discipling of one another. And that needs to change and grow. And we need to learn a variety of ways of doing that. Question number two, do you have people in your life who disciple you? Are there other Christians around you who you trust, who you are open with, who you confess sin to, who know the deep inner workings of your heart? And again, this doesn't have to be one person. It can be a variety. There can also be sometimes there's too many. Sometimes we can spread it out so much, it's just we're very disorientated. But having a group of people who trust you, you trust that there's that loving relationship with that you can really let in is so, so helpful. And sometimes you might answer and say, yeah, I know who that is. It's so-and-so and so-and-so. Maybe a good exercise is go and ask them, what's it like in our discipling relationship? Do you find it easy to bring things up with me? How do you feel like I respond if you speak the truth to me? Or vice versa. Having those conversations can be really, really helpful. And then lastly, how does your discipling of others need to grow? As I look through that list, where is it that maybe you're skewed? Do you shy away from really speaking truth? Do you conflict avoid and hide and really don't love them enough to speak up? Are you often maybe too harsh? You lack a gentleness? Maybe you speak too quickly. Maybe you jump in with answers and you've got solutions. You're very quick to quote scriptures or to give a solution rather than listening, rather than it being a flexible dynamic where you offer or you say, hey, can I give you a thought there? Or what do you need from me? Do you ask those questions or do you fly very quickly, giving the unsolicited advice really, really fast? What might it be for you? Where are areas you know you need to grow in your one another discipling relationships? I hope this has been helpful, but let me circle all the way back. Why are we sharing this? What is this all about? What's the point? I want to remember here, let's remember Jesus. This is the night Jesus was betrayed by Judas shortly after that, shortly before this verse, I should say. And then shortly afterwards, he goes to the cross, paying the ultimate price, sacrificing for us so that we can have these kind of relationships that we're talking about today. But he says here in John 13, he says, my children, I'll be with you only a little longer. You'll look for me. And just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. And by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples. If you love one another. Jesus talks about one of the very marks of being a Christian or being his disciple is how we love one another. Our one another relationships is a sign to all of those outside that we're really followers of Jesus. But to cast our moment to when did Jesus give this command? It was at that Last Supper. And this was shortly after Jesus had got up from the table. He had wrapped a towel around his waist. He'd got down at the feet of the disciples and began washing their feet. He is Lord, he is teacher, had got down amongst his students, amongst his disciples, and cleaned their feet. A radical act of love, an example that he'd set, not just in that last meal, but throughout the entirety of his life and ministry, he had obviously personified love. We know that God is love, and God in flesh through Jesus really showed and personified that love. And then he calls us to have that same kind of love. This new command, what is it that's new about this command? The newness of this command is, as I have loved you. It was a standard, a new bar almost set. How Jesus has loved us, that's how we need to love one another. We need to love one another sacrificially, putting their needs above our own. We need to love each other consistently, faithfully, perseveringly, patiently, despite difficulties and struggles, forgiving one another, constantly bearing with one another and carrying each other's burdens, as a lot of these scriptures have talked about. But the ultimate reason we do this, the ultimate reason we've talked about discipling this morning and remembering this, is because of God, because of who he is. Because he loves us so much. We just want to love each other and help each other on this walk of life, helping each other get to heaven to one day see him face to face and be with our Lord. I hope this has been helpful for you this morning. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to pray for the bread and the wine, and I'll leave those discussion questions up afterwards. So if you'd like to in your groups, you can discuss. But let me go ahead and pray now, and then we'll close. Dear Father God, we are so grateful for you. We're grateful for your love. We're grateful for your patience with us. God, all the scriptures we've looked at, you really just exemplify in every one of those areas. You're so gentle with us. You're so patient with us. You really do bear with us and persevere. All of us have made so many mistakes. We've sinned so much. All of us, maybe now or at least at sometimes, have had massive planks sticking out of our eyes, blinding us. And we've been waving those planks around, hurting each other, God. And we're so grateful that when we hurt you, you forgive us. And you're still so gracious to us. It's amazing. I pray that we can be like that to others. I pray that we can be gentle, that we can be compassionate and patient and forgiving, that we can be really consistent in each other's lives, devoted to one another, devoted to helping each other, really be more like you and helping each other as disciples to keep growing and keep flourishing. Lord, thank you for who you are. Thank you so much for your love for us and for the example of love you've set. And thank you for putting us in a family that's imperfect, a family at times we can find challenging or difficult. We all hurt one another. We can sin against one another. But a family where you've given us a way to resolve and to reconcile, to help one another as well, to have active and ongoing relationships, God. We're so grateful. Lord, we love you. Thank you so much, even this morning now, as we're going to take the bread and the wine, remembering what it was you did, remembering, God, the sacrifice you've made on the cross so that we can be free of sins, so we can be redeemed from our old way of life, brought into your kingdom of light and of love. We're grateful. We love you. And pray in your son's name. Amen. Thank you so much for joining this morning, everyone. I hope this was helpful, and I hope you have a lovely time to this morning and today. See you soon. Bye.
With sore abuse and scorn, how does that visage languish, which once was bright as morn? What thou, my Lord, hast suffered was all mine was the transgression, but thine the deadly pain. Lo, here I fall. I deserve thy place. Look on me with thy favor and grant to me thy grace. What language shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend, for this thy dying song?
On me.